You are now listening to the Salty Virgins Podcast.
Nice. Welcome to the Salty Virgins Podcast. I'm your host, Jordan. I'm joined here with my co-host, Kevin.
What up, everyone?
Also, I'm joined here by our producers and very good friends, Patrick.
How's it going?
And Jackson.
Hello.
We'd like to thank everybody for joining us. I wanted to kick things off with a wonderful after Christmas travel story that I had that was tumultuous and painful. So, I live in Atlanta. I flew home to Orlando so that I could go see my family and stuff for Christmas. You know, the happy-go-lucky shit that everybody wants to do. So, with that, I was flying back home to Atlanta from Orlando, and while I was at the airport, I had a doozy of a time. So I get to the airport around 4 o'clock. My flight's at like 7:30. I have clear, so it takes me like no time to get through TSA and stuff. So I'm hanging out at the Delta Sky Lounge, drinking, having a good time. My flight boards at, I think, like 6:40, 6:45, something like that. So I head down to my gate around 6:30. Things are kind of moving kind of weird and like unexpected around the gate. So people start looking around, being confused, you know, nobody knows what's happening. So they change our gate. We're like, okay, that's fine. We just go to the new gate. We get on the plane. Everything's fine. What ends up happening is everybody's sitting at the gate, just hanging out. Then a bunch of paramedics and like police officers like come to our gate. And we're all like very, very, very confused. And you can see like a collective of 500 people start to look around, not understand what's happening, and like be very just like upset. So they change our gate again. So 499 people get up and start shuffling through the airport while I stay behind to see what's happening. They pull a dead body off this plane.
Wait, what the fuck?
Holy shit.
What?
Those are live reactions. I've never told this story before, but yes, they pulled a dead body off the plane.
Like so the I'm captain? Like, who the fuck was on the plane?
No, like there was just an elderly gentleman who did not make it.
Oh no!
Like from the incoming flight. Holy shit!
Oh no!
Yeah. So when we moved, so when I fought, like after I saw what happened, I was like, no, I'm good on this experience. I'm gonna go, you know, to my new gate. So I talked to the gate agent. And I was like, so are we going to take off on time? And she was like, no. I was like, okay, what do you mean? She's like, we'll probably be delayed about 30 minutes because we were on one of those really, really, really big planes. I don't remember what they're called. I think it's a 7067 or something where it's got the 47? Three rows. The biggest one that Delta flies. So they can only park those on certain sides of the airport. Because, like, they're too big to, like, maneuver around. So she was like, you know, they got to figure out all the stuff at the gate or at the air traffic controller, you know. It's going to be about 30 minutes till we start boarding. And we're all like, okay, whatever. That's an inconvenience, but not the worst thing on earth. So we're waiting around at the gate. You know, people start to get antsy. It starts to be about 30 minutes, 40 minutes. There's no plane. There's precisely zero planes outside of our gate. And we're like, hey, where's our plane? And the lady's like, it'll be here, you know, they're working on it, you know, there's all kinds of stuff going on. You guys got changed for the medical emergency. She tried to play it off and I was like, yeah, no, I saw the dead body. And she was like, she was stunned. She had no idea what was happening. I was like, yeah, no, I saw that, but like that guy wasn't on our plane, so I don't understand what's happening. She didn't like that. So I was talking to her and I'm like trying to get information out of him because like I want to go home. I'm tired. I've been at the airport a long time at this point. It's about 8 o'clock, almost 8:15. But mind you, there's a winter storm going on. So like people have short windows to like make their connecting flights through Atlanta so that they can get home too. So like people are yelling. They're like, I have a flight to Detroit and I need to be on that plane. One girl who is like on my plane, she ended up getting rerouted from Orlando to New York, and then she had to stay in New York all night to fly to Denver at 4 p.m. the next day.
Oh, God.
Yeah, so people were not pleased with the way things were going. So it's about 8:30, almost 8:45, and I'm like, hey, you guys are being kind of curt. I get it. There's a storm. You're dealing with a lot of stuff, but you're not really making us feel like we're heard. So, like, is there any way we can get some free drinks or something like that, like, to make this a little bit easier when we get on the plane so we kind of forget, like, how you guys are acting?
Yeah, the finesse. Okay.
Yeah, no. I'm definitely the finesse god when it comes to things at the airport. So one dude, like, he patted his jacket and he was like, hold on, let me go get you one. That dude disappeared. I never saw that dude again. I was like, okay, I see the vision. Like, I get it. You get out of Dodge real fast. So I go back up to the gate agent, the other gate agent. It's a nice little lady. Well, I thought she was going to be nice. I was wrong. I was like, hey, one guy said he was going to go get me drink tickets. I have no drink tickets. Do you know where he's at? She's like, who are you talking about? And I was like, the black guy with dreads. She's like, there's no black guy with dreads. I was like, okay, you're going to gaslight me. Fine. Whatever. We're moving on. Can you get me drink tickets? She's like, you have to call customer care. And I was like, there's a winter storm. I would rather you shoot me than have to call customer care right now. She's like, well, that's all we can do. And I was like, I know that's not true, but I also don't want to fight with you because we're in the airport and I'm a captive audience here. Because you can get arrested at the airport real fast for anything. And, like, I was trying to make it on my flight. That was very important to me. So I just kind of let it go. So we just kind of wait around. I'm sitting at the gate, you know, playing my Switch, trying to entertain people, keep people laughing, you know, so that there's not an actual mutiny. So a pilot walks up and, like, me and the girl who ended up getting her flight, like, changed to New York, and then another guy, we were just talking, having a conversation, joking, shooting the shit. And a pilot walks up and the girl was like, you look like you can get a plane in the air. And he was like, I mean, I can. And she was like, can you get this plane in the air? And he was like, what plane? And we turn around and there's still no plane. And this is like 8:45. And we were supposed to take off at 7:25. And he was like, no, I'm just trying to get home too. Like, I just flew, like, most of the day. Like, I literally legally cannot fly anything. So he was really nice, really funny. He, like, asked, hey, so, like, they're not sitting first class, but, like, can I push for them to get upgraded or something? And I was like, that is a class move, my guy. We did not get upgraded. End of the story. But as soon as, you know, we saw the plane, everybody stood up. And they were like, that's not how boarding works. And we're like, we don't care. So they basically, like, they got all the old people on and all the kids and stuff and, like, people with kids. And then they said, if you have a ticket, get on this plane. Chaos. Chaos ensued.
Why would they possibly do that? What a fucking dumb thing to say.
I don't know. Everybody was mad. They wanted to get on the plane. I don't know. I don't know. So thankfully, like, I got on, like, I was standing by the gate, so I got on the plane a lot quicker. So it's a big plane, so there's, like, space in the aisles and stuff. So I go to the middle bathroom, and I ask one of the flight attendants, hey, so out, like, at the gatehouse, they couldn't give us drink tickets, but you guys have the drinks. Do you think that you can give me a drink or two? And she was like, we don't have the power to do that. And I was like, what do you mean you don't have the power to do that? Like, I see the drink cart. She did not give me a drink. Fine. I'll sit down in my seat. I'll be mad about it, but I'm definitely calling customer care tomorrow when all of this is settled out. So we end up taking off around 9:50-ish. And after that, we get to Atlanta. Everybody deplanes. I'm one of, like, the first 10 people off the plane. I didn't sit in the front of the plane. I didn't sit near the door. I was just ready to get off the shit. So I get off the plane. I get on the train to go, like, to my neighborhood. And halfway through the train ride, which is about 40 minutes, the train conductor stops. And, like, the whole train stops, like, in the middle of a tunnel. Because a homeless guy is walking through the train, like, the doors, like, subway doors, like, in between each car. So she's like, you can't do that.
They stop trains for that in Atlanta?
Sure do. It was terrible.
That's a joke.
So, truly, I understand. So we're just like, hey, can we move? mind you, I'm on a train at 11:40, and then the homeless guy walks past us, and then like 2 minutes later, the train conductor walked past us, like scolding us, like we were doing anything, and we're like, no, 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 it's him, and then like he got off the train, and we're like, what the fuck? You did all that to ruin the trip for everyone? So I ended up getting home at 1 a.m.
I mean, the dead body is clearly the peak of that fucking story. Can we talk? Can we get back just a little
bit? Yeah, we gotta get some details on how this dead body...
Yeah. Like, so, like, was this he guy freshly just, like, dead? Died on the plane coming in? And then they just had to, like, go scoop him up? And did they put you on the same plane? Did they remove the body from the plane? Or did they pick a new plane?
Lysol wiped down the seat.
Just sprayed it a little bit. Yeah.
I could have been
himself when he dies.
A Glade plug-in or something.
A Glade plug-in on a plane. Like,
what
is
if that was your seat, Jordan?
It could have been, for all I knew. But at the time that like I got on the plane, it didn't matter if he was still in the seat. We were getting this bitch off the ground.
Oh my god!
But so they took the dead body like
all the way in the air.
I think that's what happened because they said it was an emergency landing. Like it wasn't like they had. I don't think that plane had planned to land in Orlando.
Oh Jesus Christ! Imagine being next to that person. Like you're just sitting there, and then you just like they like sleeping, or like you think they're sleeping, like sir, and then all of a sudden it's like, buddy, he is not sleeping. excuse me, flight attendant.
Still upset. He's taking two armrests in the middle seat.
The guy in the middle seat.
You get both armrests. That's a rule.
Oh yeah, that's true.
I'm just saying, like, the guy who dies on the plane is definitely the guy who gets the middle seat. Like, he doesn't pay to have the better seat or anything. He's just like, no, I'm content just dying in the middle, being very dramatic for everyone around me.
So, when you texted us this story, Jordan, it sounded like it was, like, a super bad inconvenience. And you were just delayed 3 hours?
Yeah, 3 hours was not what I expected out of that story.
3 hours for a dead body in a winter... Like, a plane from Orlando to Atlanta that was not affected by weather. Yeah, it's a pretty big...
It sounds incredibly efficient. There was a dead body and then winter storms around the U.S. I mean,
my flight was unaffected.
Yeah, also, that's me flying Delta. There's dead bodies on Delta planes all the time.
Wait a second.
Shut up, you fly Spirit.
Yeah, and I was delayed much longer than that.
There was a hole in your plane. At least there was just a dead person on mine.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I thought it was going to be like you were delayed like half a day. Maybe you had to sleep at an airport. I don't know.
Yeah, to sleep in a cot at an airport, that would be terrible.
Yeah, that would be rough.
First of all, why would I sleep in a cot in an airport when we know 75 people who live in Orlando?
Do you want to talk to them? Oof.
Jackson?
Yeah, yeah. Question still stands.
Fair enough.
I only got one bed in my place.
You have a couch?
You sure you sleep on this couch?
I don't, but I would. I would rather sleep on that couch than a dirty airplane cot. Like, or an airport cot. Like, come on.
It'd probably just be the stretcher that they got the dead guy off.
Yeah, so I would rather take the couch. I don't understand how this is a conversation.
So you were flying back around the same time. I was actually in Atlanta for the Gator game around that time. And I wanted to ask this earlier, but I wanted you to finish your glorious story. But this kind of it ties in. So I got Kayla the bowl game ticket. I was going to get it through as a gift, and then my parents gave it to me as a gift. But like this Christmas, I had a hard time coming up with gifts because like I'm super uncreative. Like, when it comes to, like, coming up with, like, besides, I just try and, like, listen to things that she, like, oh, I want this, and then, like, a month later, if it's, like, Christmas or her birthday or whatever, like, try and get that. But as far as, like, being, like, creative and stuff, I can't do. So I tend to, like, I guess compensate for that by, like, trying to get her nicer stuff. But, like, sometimes I wonder where that kind of line is drawn. Or, like, I feel like I'm not being, like, creative enough or whatever, so I just get her, like, a slightly nicer thing. Is that, like, do you guys kind of do that as well when gift giving, or is that just me?
So I usually, now that I make more money, I usually do large amounts, like large gifts. But when I was a broke boy or more of a broke boy, I'd write letters and stuff like that. I mean, I don't think at least Kara really, she appreciates the big gifts, but I think she would appreciate like more, something more meaningful. So I tend to lean that way, or something like a little thing that she says just offhand, and you buy that for her. She wanted a phone case, so it was like a $10 phone case, but she's been looking for one, so I finally went out and got one for her for Christmas, and that's probably her favorite gift that she got.
But to me, like, if I just show up to the doorstep with just a $10 phone case, like, it could be super cool, but, like, that just feels, it just feels like not enough to me. Like, I don't know.
I mean, it's situational.
It's definitely situational. I've definitely been, you know, apply pressure with, like, the really nice gift or, like, something big, but the big thing can also be thoughtful,
right? So I think I got Kara a Fitbit Versa for Christmas too, but when she went to my family's house, she was showing off her phone case, like she was excited about the phone case. So I mean, it's really something that they have more interest in too. You just got to be more in tune with what they're thinking.
You have to listen and be a good partner. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, that's basically what I'm saying.
Wait a second. But
I'm not saying that Kevin's not a good partner. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying, like, for Kara, she wanted the phone case, so I went out and got it for her. This is, like, a little thing that she really wanted.
But my main point is that, like, I do that stuff, so, like, but if I just have, like, three or four, like, $5 gifts, like, I get it. I don't know. I think part of it is knowing, like, my financial situation. I, like, can buy more decent gifts. I would feel like if I just got like a couple little $5 gifts, it would feel like I was almost like cheaping out on that holiday. So I'll do like a couple little things like that, and then maybe one big thing. But I think part of that comes from being in varying economic situations,
right? So you've been dating her for like eight years now, so it's harder to come up with little things.
Yeah, I don't know. To me, it just comes from like I literally just like she'd be like, oh yeah, like I wanted this like candle or something. I just like I literally write that shit in my phone, and then the next gift giving opportunity, if she doesn't have it yet, I get it for her. Stuff like that. So it's more like just kind of picking up on little stuff that she probably won't buy. Like, you know, that kind of stuff that, like, I wouldn't buy for myself. But right. If I received it, I would, like it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Okay. What about for us? Do you like the sentimental gift? Or do you like when the pressure is applied with a nice big monetary gift?
Well, with you guys, like, with my friends, I've always kind of... I've never consistently gotten, like, almost any of my friends, like, a gift for every holiday.
I was about
to
say, when
like
have any of us gotten gifts for each other?
But my thing is, like, if... What I have done in the past is, like, for one of my roommates in college or something, it was, like, I was literally just, like, on Amazon or something, and I saw a shirt, and I was, like, holy shit, he would really like that. And I, like, it was around his birthday, so I was, like, I'll just get it for him for his birthday. But I don't, like, I don't have, like, even, like, you guys are, like, my best friends, and I don't consistently give you guys gifts every holiday. But if something comes up, and I think, oh, that'd be a good gift for that person, I will do a gift like that. But I don't feel that pressured with my friends to, like... consistently buy gifts for every holiday, because then for every holiday, like big gift giving holiday, like Christmas and stuff, you're shopping for like so many people on a yearly basis, and I don't know if most people want to be put under that pressure. I know I don't. Like, I like shopping for my select group of like family and Kayla, basically.
Right. I just did that recently with our friend Lucas. He's a big Argentina fan, so I was just at Dick's and I saw that they had an Argentina shirt on sale, so I went and bought it. We were just about to see him for his birthday, so I just bought it for his birthday. I mean, I don't like go out and buy gifts for my friends, but like if I see something that they'd be interested in and it's like in my means, sure, I'll buy from.
We have never gotten each other gifts. I want the pod to know that.
Jordan doesn't like enough things, so it's really tough to shop for him.
I like a lot of things, just the things that I like are either expensive or I'll just get them myself, and like they can't time that out.
That's true. I'm not same way. That's Kayla complains about that way for me too, is like I either like have a list of expensive things that I want, but anything under $25 I can have at my doorstep in like a day. It's just like,
oh yeah, right, big time. Yeah.
And that's where that's definitely where Kara gets upset with me, is that when I say I want something, I buy it within the week.
Yeah, like if I want something, I will have it. When we were like, hey, let's, you know, start a podcast, I was like, okay, I'll have the mics to my house, you know, in 2 days.
Right.
Yeah. So you received them to your house and didn't test them for months until we started doing this.
What a
so you're not that excited about it.
Not necessarily,
because so they didn't work.
If we spent
they
like,
work.
Yeah, we spent we like 4 hours trying to get those mics to work, and it turns out you didn't have the right thing.
Yeah. For all everybody listening, if you guys listen to the first episode, there's probably about 25 hours of work that went into that stupid.
Not
first
25.
Episode.
It was like eight.
Well, it combined with Patrick's editing time.
Okay.
Yeah, there was probably around 25 hours into that.
Yeah. We had to figure it out. We knew there was going to be big startup costs on this, but we wanted to do this because we're really good friends and we love each other. And, you know, I was never meant to be Mr. Technical. I was always meant to be talking guy. So I tried my best. and my friend shit on me.
You didn't try your best.
Not even close to your best. Buying like, one Google search really works.
From Fat Kids Deals is not trying very hard at all.
I disagree.
He tried his best. Disagree. He tried his best.
I did. I tried as hard as I could. Again, this goes back to I had the financial means, so I bought it. I didn't know any. First of all, none of us knew how any of this worked. We figured it out, you know, later on in the day of podcasting. So don't let them act like they knew this right away, because they didn't. Like,
I don't know, once we get the mic situation figured out, it came by pretty fast.
Yeah, but the mic situation, like, none of us knew you couldn't use the mics I had.
Well, because, no one knew what mics you had.
Yeah, you had the mics, not us.
Yeah, and you did little research, or even told us what you had, or did anything.
I definitely sent pictures, but it's...
All right, I think we can all agree that this is all Jordan's fault.
Yeah,
yeah, you're right. We're here because of my idea... We're here because of my idea to start a podcast. You're right. Wow.
So circling back to yeah, shout out Jordan. Congrats.
Yeah.
So circling back to like significant other gift giving and I guess just gift giving in general. Like if we dig down into
our bags.
Going back to like the little sentimental gifts, like are those? I was reading an article the other day and it was talking about like how. I think it was based off a TED Talk, but it was talking about how, like, in a relationship, a sum up of the little things matters so much more than the big things. And that's, like, that's a fact that when someone says it doesn't sound, like, that shocking. But when I really got to thinking about it, it was, like, it's kind of insane because, like, I know I go and, like, these, like, big things. Like, oh, we're going to this cool concert. We're going on this cool vacation. Like, those big moments are so cool and so memorable. But when you, like, think back on, like, the things that are, like, really the coolest about you know, for me, it's like a significant other relationship, but this can even be with like just personal relationships with people. It's like, I'm such good friends with you guys because we can literally just sit around, you know, record on a Thursday night and talk for a couple hours, and I find it interesting and fun. So it's like, have all the sum of the little things is really the more important thing in a lot of your relationships. And I don't know if you guys have like noticed that same kind of thing or have any kind of opinions on that.
Yeah. So, like, one of the little things is like, I know it's obvious, but like, listening is a little thing that goes a long way, especially in my relationship. Like, I'll always be questioning, like, did you hear that? Or, like, are you listening to me? And I'll repeat exactly what she said. And that's something that she's impressed by because what I assume is that in her previous relationships, her partner didn't listen very much. And I feel like being able to listen to your partner and being able to actively engage in a conversation with them is a little thing that'll go a long way.
I can't say I'm the best at that. Oh,
yeah.
God.
Kevin is the worst at that. Kevin has never listened to anyone ever, really.
No. It's called selective listening. Yeah. I listen very intently about
your dad has the same thing, dude.
His dad will look his mother in the face, hear everything she said, and just, like, not care. It's one of the funniest things I've ever seen.
Not that he doesn't care.
I mean, his mom says a lot of things, though, so I can't really blame him.
Yeah, shout out Nancy. Shout out Nancy and Jose if you're listening. Pat hates you.
No, wait a second. That's not what I meant at all.
That's exactly what I heard.
Oh my god.
This topic.
I'm cutting this out.
This topic spawned from a kind of a late night tweet that I had about one of my exes who every time I would bring home food, whether it be Chipotle or, you know, whatever, she would set out all the utensils I needed and like kind of make it ready for me when I would like finish walking the dog. And it was just one of those little things like listening or like remembering something I said or something like that, that really kind of stuck with me. Cause like ultimately it's inconsequential, but it did mean like a lot in those moments. I was like, oh, this is really nice and really sweet. And like, it was a nice act of service that made me feel good.
Yeah. I mean, Carol will come over, I don't know, whenever she comes over my house and she'll just do my dishes. Like, I was gonna do my dishes, but she comes over and just does it for me.
And yeah, because you're a dirty bachelor.
Well, I mean, I don't really have that many dishes in my set. Like, maybe a few cups and a
Patrick
bowl
owns
or two.
Four plates.
Yeah, I don't really have.
He used to own about five cups.
But like, yeah, I mean,
a set of dishes is $20 at Target. That's what she.
I don't ask her to. But she comes and washes them, and I really appreciate that. And that's something, a little thing that she does.
That is very cute and sweet, and shout out her. But also, plates are $20 at Target. Please buy some.
I have four plates. I'm okay on that.
That's not enough plates.
How many plates is enough plates?
A full set.
What's a full set?
I mean, for you, if you're just one person living in a house, I think if you have, like, five or six large plates and five or six smaller plates, because, like, you're never going to go through all of those, but, like, right. Think about if you have a couple friends over. Like, even if that,
we if, come if, over if to have, do yeah. the pod.
Well, I have four large plates and four small plates.
It wouldn't hurt to have a few more, but I think you're bored. You know, that's the thing is, like, if you have a couple people over, it's like, you have to start rationing. And not that that's the end of the world, but, like, when it's so inexpensive and you do have, like, storage for it, it's like, why not?
I don't have the storage for it.
You have nowhere to put plates?
You don't have nowhere to put four plates? What? I don't... What kind plate of Alice stack. In Wonderland apartment do you live in? I've been there.
Well, if it was an Alice in Wonderland apartment, he would have places to put it. He could... Like, I don't understand... Plate stack, Patrick.
All right, let's hear him out. What's going on?
Stack 20. No, I mean, my cabinets aren't very big. That's where I put my food. Like, I don't know. I don't think you're overestimating how much storage I have in my apartment.
I don't know. I think purchasing a couple more plates really wouldn't break the bank on you, but that's just me.
No, it wouldn't. I just don't need them.
I'll buy them when the truth comes out. I see. Okay. All right.
So if we have a podcast, like a dinner podcast, Patrick's going to be like, BYOP.
I will not host.
You can go buy some paper plates for us.
I have a shit ton of paper plates. I went to Sam's and got some.
How many forks do you own? I think this is important.
I have a lot of forks. I probably have like 15 forks.
What are you saying?
Why do you have an uneven number of forks?
It's not. They're like mismatched forks. So I got them. I got some from my sister and some from a set that I had.
Okay. Yeah, that's acceptable.
In my house, it's like, because I live with three other roommates, right? So there's like just like a lot of mismatched stuff in the kitchen, but I think most of the silverware is mine. And I just have like this accumulation of silverware that I think I've picked up in a couple different places that I live, because everyone always combines silverware. I've lived with a lot of roommates a lot of times. So everyone kind of combines stuff and then you just kind of try and take your stuff. So I have just like this mixed bag of like forks, spoons, and knives. I just like, there's no like semblance of a set anymore, but we have a surplus of it.
It's good. I'm glad to know that I can eat dinner at your house and not have to wash a plate to, like, eat dessert.
No, if you go to Kevin's house, you definitely have to wash a cup to get a cup.
No, that's not true.
Every time I've been there, I've had to wash a cup to get a cup.
That's not true. That's just false. Also, you've been there once. Okay.
Three times. I've been there three times.
Mm, all right. No, to my new place in Jacksonville?
Yeah.
You've been once.
I've been three times.
Nah, I'm not buying it.
Okay.
That sounds fake to me.
Yeah, I'm choosing not to believe you.
You could believe what you want to believe, but that's the truth.
Man, maybe we need to start monetizing this motherfucker. Thanks for listening. Here's a break.
Hell nah, I ain't sleep today, but I'ma be okay. Miss my family on the east, but fuck it, I can't leave LA. Every meeting that I be in, trust me, I just lead the way. I fucked three times before three today. Piece of cake, never gave a fuck about what the teachers say. Cause either way, I'ma just do me and she sent me to...
Going along with the relationship thing, so it's pretty much the end of my vacation right now, so I hadn't really done anything, so I took care of... I got a hotel room at the Universal Resort, just spur of the moment kind of thing, because I was coming to my end of my vacation. And the park was so fucking packed, guys. Like, every ride was 120 minutes, 140 minutes. And I just want to know your feelings about theme parks in general and being around
theme
people
parks
like that.
Are certifiably terrible. Like, I guess that's unfair. That's unfair as a blanket statement, because, like, I do enjoy, like, I had Islands of Adventure. And it's like, it was like really cool. I really like Busch Gardens, but like, you might have to pay me to have a Disney pass and like actually go. Like,
okay, Disney is a different thing. Like,
that's the big boy in Florida. Like, Epcot, I know a lot of people love Epcot. Epcot to me kind of sucks. I mean, if I'm drinking around the world, sure. But
only reason to go to Epcot. Only reason to go to Epcot is to drink.
If I want to spend $125 to spend another $125, I'm not going to Epcot. But the only reason I didn't have a Universal Pass in college was because Jackson has motion sickness. So, we couldn't go together. So, when I would go visit him, we would just have to go to pub. Yuck.
Oh, God.
Because, like, he couldn't, like, get on the ride, so it would be a waste of money for us to go. But, like, I love Universal. I love Carowinds. I really want to go to Cedar Point in Ohio. Like, Disney is fine. I think after a certain age, if you go to Disney by yourself or, like, with people over the age of 25, it's a little weird, personally. But, you know, that's my thing. Like, I love roller coasters. I love thrill rides, that kind
of
stuff.
Over the age of 25, to go to Disney, you probably need a kid.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
yeah.
I love the roller coasters themselves are incredible. But my thing is, like, now in order to go to a theme park, I don't live in a town that has a theme park within a couple hours, right? Not the end of the world, but if I want to go to, like, Universal or Busch Gardens or something, it has to be a day trip or, like, a multiple day trip that I stay over there. So then, like, I have to plan that around now. If I'm going to a theme park, I'm wanting to go, like, for half a day when it's not that crowded. So I'm not going to be going on, like, Saturdays, right? So, like, when I had the Universal Pass, I would go stay in Orlando with, like, Pat or some other friends, and you can go for, like, half a day and hit a couple rides that you want to do and go home. Like, right. If I live near one, that to me is the move. But now
that's the only way to do theme parks now.
Yeah.
I agree. I strong agree. Because I went
too many people. Too many people.
Last time I went with some pass holders, so they got, like, the fast passes and all this stuff. So we, like, hit the stuff we wanted to hit, and then we went, like, drinking elsewhere, like, by, like, 3 o'clock. It was really nice. It was a much better situation than, like, having to, like, be handcuffed to being there all day. It's also hot, like, in Florida. It's hot
and expensive. Like, if I want a water,
really expensive.
It's $5 for a bottle of water. So it's, like, it ends up not really being worth it if you don't, like, plan it out right.
Yeah, and just walking around crowds. One of the worst things about theme parks is the people in, like, Rascal Scooters who don't need to be in Rascal Scooters. It's, like, the most annoying thing. Like, so one time I was at Disney, and I was, like, getting in line for a ride, and this lady was trying to, like, exit the line in her Rascal Scooter, and she, like, honked at me and then ran over my foot and then yelled at me. She's like, "Move!" I'm like, "What? There's no way that she should have the right of way in a tight passage like that." It was one of the most annoying things I've ever gone through at a theme park.
I actually have a pretty funny theme park story, but it's many years old. For my 16th birthday, I did not get a driver's license. That was a whole thing. I got promised a trip to Universal. I turned 16 in May. We did not go to Universal until late July. I was very upset.
You still
went, my mother. Yeah. You know who I am about my birthday.
That's true.
That was not good enough for me. So my mother and grandmother promised they would take me. We would go. It would be a great time. It was not. I was told we're leaving at 9. Me being the excited, you know, former birthday boy, really, it was right after Harry Potter had opened, but, like, with enough space where, like, you could go and it wouldn't be wall-to-wall packed. So I'm super excited. I'm, like, ready up, got my drawstring backpack and my running shoes and, like, probably some terrible shorts on. Probably cargo shorts, if we're being honest.
Been there.
Yeah, it was
tap out shirt. Times.
No, I never wore tap-out shirts. Thank God. So, I'm ready to go. 9 o'clock comes. Nothing is happening. I'm like, "Hey, are we leaving? What's happening? What's happening? What's happening?" They're like, "Yeah, we're about to leave. We're about to leave." I was like, "Okay. I'll be, you know, sitting here on the couch, probably playing my Game Boy or something. I'm ready, so please just come get me when you're ready." So, we leave about 9:45. We get in the car. And I am then informed, "Oh, we have to stop at AAA." As a 16-year-old, first of all, you don't even know why you're stopping at AAA. I'm like, how long is this going to take?
Yeah, you're getting scammed.
I sure was. I got scammed out of a whole day. So we went to AAA. Apparently, they do discounts on theme park tickets.
Yeah, they used to.
When I was 16, I did not know that.
Yeah.
That would have been nice to know. So I was like, "Okay, this shouldn't take that long." I was wrong. It took 45 minutes. We sat in a AAA office for 45 minutes for them to give us $10 off of the theme park tickets. And there were three of us. It wasn't worth our time. So we leave AAA. We get on the highway, but we don't get on the fast highway. We get on kind of it's 192, which is not really a highway, if you're asking me. It's, I don't even know how to explain it. It took us an hour and 45 minutes to make it to Universal when it should take an hour door to door.
Your mom just went to AAA for 45 minutes to get $10 off her Universal ticket. She's not taking toll roads to Universal. You gotta know
fair,
that.
Fair point. This is yeah.
You know what? I probably should have thought about that. You know, I should have saw that coming. You're right. That was on me. So it's like noon when we make it into the park. I am upset, visibly and audibly. So we get in the park. My mother and grandmother are like, we're hungry. I almost fell on the ground with anger. I was like, I don't care. You can eat later. We're here to ride rides and see Harry Potter. They're like, we're gonna eat now. I was like, I don't really want to do this. Please don't make me act an ass for my present. So we go, we eat. It's a whole thing. And they're like, we want Cinnabon. I was like, okay, I'm getting on the Hulk. I'm not interested in this anymore. Like, I'm done with this. Like, I'm getting on the ride, single rider. I'll see you guys, you know, when you're done with your Cinnabon. So I meet up with them after they're done with, after I ride the Hulk. They're, like, finally ready to walk around and do things. So Harry Potter's in the back of the park, and the Hulk's kind of near the front-ish of the park. So we walk to the back. That takes much longer than it needed to. We get a butter beer. We get on the roller coaster. That's great. Everything's great. I'm like, okay, the day's really rolling. And then my grandmother gets sick. And she's just like, we have to leave. It's Wait, 3 got, o'clock.
Got sick? Not like after the Harry Potter ride?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. No, I cannot do that ride. That ride really? Fucks me up. Yeah, no, I cannot do that one.
Interesting.
Actually, I had a friend at UCF who worked on her. She spent her whole summer internship working on how to make people vomit less on that ride.
Jesus Christ.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I had no... I didn't have an issue then, and I don't have an issue now. That's interesting. Well, yeah, she got sick. It's like 3 o'clock. She's like, we have to leave. And I was like, we sounds like a lot of people. Like, I'm willing to stay here and figure it out on my own until tomorrow. But we leave. I throw a fit in the car. There's a lot of yelling. There's a lot of hurt feelings. And I never went to a theme park again with my parents. Ever.
Yelling and hurt feelings seems to be a just strong trend in your household.
Yeah, that's the football special right there.
Facts. We are not a productively expressive people. We just get mad and then yell very mean and hurtful things at each other. And then act like they didn't happen.
That sounds really healthy.
No, it's great. I've, you know, grown up to be a wonderful, emotionally mature, you know, young man. Everything's great.
It sounds like it. You threw a fit at 16.
Yeah. You
know, this is a fair point. 16 years old, it seems like it's too many years old for that.
Listen, I will still throw a fit at 23. I don't know what you're talking about. Jackson, do you know how close I was to throwing a fit in Vegas? I was very close. If we weren't in such close proximity, like, I would have thrown a fit in a way that would not have been productive to anything. Because it was 2 a.m., we were all tired, and we were all mad.
Yeah, I'm glad we didn't see that. I don't need to see any of your family rage come out.
It wouldn't have been rage. Like, I just would have been mad. Like, I don't know how to describe it. It just would have... It would have been childish. That's what it would have been. I would have just been a big-ass baby.
Man, this would be a great place to put an ad. Oh, well. We gon' get this paper. With that on my mind. You gon' see us later. With that on my mind. Monica and Ava. Thanks for all the favors. Got my money saved up. With that on my mind. We gon' get this paper. With that on my mind.
Time where we were at Jordan's house and his mom was like on the phone with someone who locked their kid in the car.
Yes. Oh my god. she used to work as a calling agent for an insurance company, right?
Yeah.
It was AAA. She worked my mom. Yes. But okay. This story kind of comes full circle because now I know why she knew that, because she used to work for AAA. Yeah, she used to work for AAA, and she worked for, like, the call center. So, like, she would dispatch, like, the drivers and the locksmiths and all kinds of stuff like that. So one time, Kevin and Patrick were just at my house hanging out, and my mom was working, but, like, it didn't matter because she was on the phone and we were just hanging out. So one of the calls she took was a lady locked her kid inside the house and then her keys inside her car.
That's what it was.
Yeah.
So at this point, I don't think I knew anything about what your mom was doing. I knew she worked a job where she had to be at her phone, but we were just, like, sitting out in the living room and her desk was, like, out in the common area. And all of a sudden she's just talking and we're not paying her any mind, but then all of a sudden she's like, is the kid okay? Like, your son's okay, right? And then she asked a question about keys, and we just all stopped what we were doing. We were like, what is happening? hold on. Just hold the phone. So we're like eavesdropping. And she's like trying to describe to us the situation while on the phone with this lady, which is a valiant effort by her.
Yes, and she was like, she had to do it while three teenagers sat there, gawked and laughed at one, how dumb this lady was, but two, how expressive my mom was trying not to be. While she was at work, mind you. Like, she was getting paid to do this job. And, like, if she was gonna laugh, like, she was gonna get fired. But she was willing to risk it all to tell us this story.
So, yeah, they had to dispatch a locksmith out. Wasn't her kid ended up being in the house without, like, in the house, like, locked in there for, like, 20 or 25 minutes. Like, it wasn't a short period of time. They had to get, like, a locksmith out dispatched to, like, get her keys out of her car. But it was such a bizarre sequence of events. And, like, we were just hearing your mom state it back to her. So we're just sitting there, and all of a sudden we would hear, like, oh, yeah, so, but your son's doing okay, right? Like, okay, so we're getting a locksmith. And that was enough. We were just like, oh, hold on a second. Oh. And it was just the most absurd, like, yeah. So yeah. I wonder, do you know if, like, that was that more of a commonplace thing for her, or was that one of the more wild experiences?
That was definitely one of the wilder ones that we got to witness. Most of them were, I locked my keys in my car, or I got a flat tire, or, you know, my battery died. Very common things that could happen to literally anybody.
Yeah, okay.
But that one was definitely an outlier, and I don't think she ever had a call quite like that ever again. And she did that job for, like, 2 or 3 years.
Well, that almost sounds like, that sounds very close to a call. I guess since the kid was, like, in the house, I don't know, it was a little bit better, but that almost sounds like a call that should be directed to emergency, like, service is not, at that point, not your AAA agent. Like, I don't think I would think to call AAA, because I don't have AAA, so I don't, like, think about that anyway, but I don't think I would think to call them for any, like, real emergencies. It would just be like, oh, I got a flat tire, oh, I ran out of gas. That's what I think of AAA as, so that's just wild that people were like, yeah, by the way, also, I locked my kid in my house, can you help?
Well, I think the I locked my keys in my car triggered for her to call AAA because they can get the keys out of the car so she could get into the house.
Yeah, that's true.
And, like, I don't think her kid was in any sort of life impending danger. I think she was getting ready to go, so the kid was probably in the car seat or, like, whatever.
The kid was in just the house.
Like, but your kid can be in the house and in a, like, the baby carriage.
Oh, yeah, we don't know how old the kid was either.
So, like, you know, they're stationary, they're fine, like, they're not gonna, you know, nothing's gonna happen, really. So, overall, like, you could just leave the kid.
So, how do you think this happened? She put her kid down, then she went to her car, turned it on, or, like, realized that she didn't have her kid with her, and then locked her keys in her car, and then realized that her door was locked?
Probably just like
that. It had
like
to be
that.
A pretty acute sequence. It must have been,
that's
like, almost
exactly.
That's
a huge fuck-up.
Listen,
like, I've done... I don't know if I ever locked myself out of a house, but I've definitely locked my keys in a car. But then to do those two at the exact correct moment so that you can't get into either is pretty big bummer.
You gotta try,
the phone
really.
Yeah, I was about to say, the positive is she had her phone and everything, you know, kind of worked out. She got her kid out of the house and the keys out of the car.
So, and now we're telling her story for everyone to hear, for all, you know,
would
thousands
you guys want...
and thousands of listeners.
Would you guys want to have that job? What your mom did, or
absolutely
you,
not?
What a worse job.
Have you given a choice? No, not a chance. Any job that I have to talk to people, not like in a collaborative setting, but like where like your mom's still providing a service at that point. Like service industry jobs, like they're more to me they're usually more of a means to an end because they're the hardest work ever and sometimes not super rewarding.
Also, this was not my mother's first job. Like she was more than capable of not. Like doing this job, she was just like, I want something else to do. So
right,
she did
I'm not,
this.
I'm not saying. Yeah.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying, like, to set this up, like, this was just like a passion project for my mother. And she was like, yeah, this is fine. Like, I'll just put up with the dumbest people that have ever existed on Earth.
It's a bold passion project.
That's what I'm saying. Like, it was a wild thing to do. Because, like, when you lock your keys in your car, you're not necessarily the nicest person. Because, like, you realize that your thing is important, but you don't realize that you're speaking to a person with feelings on the other end. So people would, like, yell and shit. And she'd be like, sir, I need you to calm... Sir, you need to calm down. She had to do that a lot.
Yeah, so, I can imagine.
What are some worse jobs than that?
Buddy.
Like that we've done? Or from her, or what?
Sure, if you have personal experience. Like, I worked at Publix as a bagger, and man, that job sucked.
If you work in retail, like Publix as a bagger, that's probably shitty. Working in retail in any sense, terrible.
The amount of old people that tried to put their hands in my pockets to give me tips was way too many. Way too many.
Did you let them put their hands in your pocket?
No.
Oh, he did. You know he did.
It happened okay probably did, like Patrick. Maybe so four once. Or five times.
Okay.
No, four or five times. Older ladies tried to put dollar bills in my pockets for bringing their groceries out.
Singular dollar bills or like a wad of dollar bills?
Like $2.
Why yeah, did just you
like
just
some loose change?
Why did you ASMR us for that?
So I never had like a bad job. Like I refereed soccer going all the way through middle school and high school, and that like as someone that loves soccer is incredible because you make decent money, you pick your own hours, and you're like refereeing soccer. But like the lows of that are just very, very low. Because
you
like,
get shit on all the time.
And it's not even like I reffed all the way up to like 18-year-olds, and usually when it's that, like the players are a little bit worse, the parents aren't that bad. But I reffed a under 10 tournament final in Orlando, and I thought these parents were going to kill me. We had to throw like 7 parents out of the game because one got mad about a call and then one started defending the call from the opposite teams. And then parents just like started breaking out, like screaming at each other in a fight.
Jesus.
And it was like, and then like there was a mix of like white and Hispanic kids on the teams too. So like some parents talk in Spanish, some are in English. It was just a mess. And like, to be fair, like soccer parents are bad. I mean, I guess any sport, like their child is bad, but it was like that job was just like so good most of the time. But there was like literally a couple times where I was like 15, 16 years old. Like I think my mom had to drive me to that. Like I don't think I had my license yet. And these parents, you know, it's like 30 something year old humans are screaming at me. This like kid on the sidelines with a little flag about over like an offsides call. And it was just like the most surreal experience. And I think after that, like playing soccer, I was a little bit, like, I'm still a dickhead to refs, but I was a little bit nicer for sure. So I was like, holy shit, like, it gets really bad over here.
Yeah, I think sports brings out the worst in some people.
Yeah,
any type of competitive sport.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is the
intramural
the
refs?
Oh, God.
Intramural refs in college?
To be an intramural ref. Oh, my God, that'd be the worst.
Yeah, I thought about it, and then I realized, like, I said some pretty choice things, and I was like, I don't want to have to fight. Like on the intramural field, but I like after I thought about taking that job, I was like, you know what, I'm gonna not swear at the refs. That's what I'm gonna do this year. I'm just not gonna swear at the refs. Like I'll tell them they're bad at their jobs. I'll make up funny ref puns, but I'm not gonna swear at them.
That's a pretty
I think
fair
that,
step.
Yeah.
If you swear at the ref at UCF, you get kicked out of the game.
Yeah.
You also
yeah,
have to pay
you get kicked
to
out
take
of for doing that.
What? Yeah, no, intramurals is free at UCF.
Oh, was it?
I mean,
free
it might be
if
part
you
of the fees.
Forfeited enough games for us, you had to pay like a penalty. But it was
yeah,
free
yeah.
to like enter as a student and all that.
No,
kind
if
stuff.
You if you forfeited a game like within 24 hours, then you had to pay $30.
Yeah, I think that might have been it for us as well.
Okay.
But I like for most things, it was like pretty casual. Like I played like a bunch of intramurals, but it was always pretty fun. Even though if I played in competitive leagues, but the men's soccer was always just like. That was, like, one of the most competitive sports at UF. Like, that football and basketball were, like, the three, like, really, really, at least from my experience, right? Mm-hmm. And it was, like, man, there were times where this is, like, two very, very good soccer teams playing in, like, a semifinal. And, like, this ref is making, like, minimum wage. He may have never played soccer in his life. He's just, like, doing this because he, like, heard about it. But it's, like, there are some times that those refs got just beat down. And then I was like, I could never do that for the salary that they pay. Like, I as a youth ref was making like twice what they make as intramural refs, because you're being paid by clubs that the players play to be a part of. Whereas like at UF, it's just like, you know, in any college, right? It's just like someone that works for the gym that helps them by refereeing games. So that's just like, I could not have done that. That's just too much abuse.
Yeah. It's a rough life out there for a ref.
Yeah, not great. Fun if you like the sport, but it also just really depends. Like, most games are really good, but the ones that are bad are just like, people are just so mean. And I know, like, I've done it too. It's like, it's really brutal.
Yeah, I always had teammates that yelled at the refs, and I'd always go up to them and apologize, especially in football.
Oh yeah, big time.
Well, freaking flag guarding calls, man.
Oh my god,
Jesus.
Flag guarding is not even a real penalty. Get out of here.
I'm convinced the football refs didn't know the rules to football. It was incredible.
They didn't. No. Of course they didn't. That's why they were intramural refs. What? They were just people. They needed warm bodies, and they're like, you know, here's a flag. What?
So
what? Actual refs don't know the rules of football.
That's fair.
NFL referees still don't know.
There's one time we're on a drive to end the half. There's like 2 minutes left, and they fucked up some call, and then they gathered together to talk about it, and then they took so long, and then they called halftime.
that's not how that
I'm like,
works.
Yeah, I'm like, wait, you guys didn't stop the clock?
Oh no, they keep a running. They're on a tight schedule, man. They keep a running clock for everything.
Yeah, they're like, no, it's a running clock under 2 minutes. And I'm like, okay,
that's like, seems like the opposite of correct. I don't know. Yeah,
I didn't know what to say. Like, I didn't want. It was.
Yeah, no. At that point, you just kind of roll with it.
Yeah, you just walk away.
See, I never got into competitive. I did like the rec football, and we would like have a beer in the parking lot before games because we were just not like, it was fun, but we were not trying to win. Because the people that play flag, I am not like, I can do very little on a flag football field besides catch and run routes. So I was really just going out there because people needed bodies, and it was fun. Yeah. But soccer and basketball, the ones like, I got dunked on playing rec 3-on-3 basketball, and I was like, I didn't really want to play again after that. It was like, man, I want to play and have fun, but I'm not trying to get dunked on. That's just not what I set out to do this morning.
Yeah, that's not what it's about.
Got a man not at too. All. Jesus. Not a good look for me.
Getting dunked on is never good.
Not good. No.
Never a good look.
It's a one-time thing for me.
You know, I got dunked on by my own roommate in college. It was very painful. And I'm still upset about it. 4 years later.
Like, physically painful or mentally painful?
Por que los dos on that one.
Yeah. Also, he for sure made fun of him relentlessly, probably still to this day, about it.
You know, he doesn't really bring it up.
He's probably dunked on so many people. He can hoop, so.
Yeah, he was really good.
And like, Jordan is so bad 5 foot at basketball, six. Too.
I'm 5 foot six. Sterling
Jordan
is
very bad
six
at basketball,
three.
For the record.
Oh, it was Sterling?
Yeah,
yes.
Still, Jordan is so bad at basketball.
Correct, yes. But also, I was getting dunked on by somebody who was very, very large.
How tall is Sterling?
6'3", almost 6'4". He played college basketball. Like, I had no chance. I don't know why I did it. I was like, I can do this. I couldn't even get my arms high enough to hack him. Like, that's what happened.
Yeah, I'm not stepping onto a court with someone that's that good. Like, that's good. I'm glad you're really good. But, like, I just don't need... This is, like, some special kind of shame with something like that happening.
Yeah.
Or someone making you fall. Like, I don't think I've ever, in, like, a pickup game, had someone make me fall. But I've seen it happen to people. And it's just the worst. Like, I just... For that person that just went down, it's like, buddy, you gotta go home. There's just no more. The whole gym just exploded at your expense.
Do you have to take off your shoes and just, like, walk out?
Just head down, just leave.
Like, throw them outside, like, on a power line outside the gym.
You walk out in your socks.
Just embarrassed. Leave your bag and everything. I won't need this anymore.
Yeah, no, you're never returning to that gym ever again, either. You're switching to a Crunch Fitness.
Yeah. I've never really been cross-playing basketball, but whenever I played at LA in, like, my running shoes... Running shoes are terrible to play on, like, wood floors, because they always, like, catch. So I've tripped, like, 3 or 4 times just running down the court.
That's not good.
Yeah, I know. I'm a big boy when I fall, too. I make a loud thud.
Are you not a big boy when you walk, or
we don't have
jog?
To talk about, We don't have to talk.
That's stumbling down the court.
We don't have to talk.
We literally talked about the fact that we were big boys on the last episode.
Yeah.
Like we're just all like big boys.
The loudest thud. Like you dropping a sack of potatoes.
I'd like to thank everybody for listening. We've had a wonderful time talking to each other. We're having a wonderful time interacting with you guys. Make sure to follow us on Twitter at Salty Virgins Pod. We are just blessed and thankful to, you know, be able to do this and you guys like it. If you have anything you want us to talk about, why don't you just, you know, mention us or, you know, DM us, and we'll definitely, you know, try and work it into our next one. And again, I would like to say thank you. We really, really, really appreciate all of you.
Peace.